about it. So if I talk about it, just hold on. Yes. When we use any robotic arm, then our first aim is to do some application with it. Like why we want to use it for pick and place, we want to use it for welding, we want to use it for doing some painting work. Now, the ultimate aim is to reach to the desired path and then perform the required operation. So if I'm talking about going to a particular path and doing an operation, that means I have a desired path, which is already there. So I want my robotic arm to reach to that path, start from there, and then do the intended operation. So if I'm saying intended operations, that means I'm saying that it is about a welding, about painting, and whatever the application I'm interested in. So I want to give instruction to the robotic arm that reach to a point A, then move from A to B through circle or through straight line or through arc or whatever be the desired path that I want. So that means if suppose I have a robotic arm with six axes, then reaching to a particular point A, it has to move all those axes with respect to each other so that robotic arm reaches to a final destination, which is my point A, right? So while it is doing its various calculations, moving its links, joints with respect to each other, then there involves is a kinematics. So this kinematics is about transforming the axis from link or joint one to second to third to fourth to fifth and finally to sixth, if this is a six-axis robotic arm. Now it becomes very difficult to align to do that transformation from one axis to another axis. If we go by the simple kinematic equations, as you must have read in engineering mechanics. Now there comes the help from DH parameter. Dennewert, this Hartenberg parameters. These are the DH parameters which are known. And these are the total four parameters which completely describe the transformation from one axis to another. So in today's lecture, we will be talking about these DH parameters. What are these DH parameters? How one axis can be transformed to another? And finally, how we can move from the base to the end effector through these transformation matrices. So if you understood these DH parameters, then half of the work is done for you. If you are working as an engineer to move the robotic arm from the base to the final intended end effector. So with that thing in our mind, we'll be doing this lecture, that is kinematics. So if I start with this lecture, suppose I say, where is my hand? If I say this thing, as a human being, or if I'm talking about a robot, then where is my hand? If I'm saying where is my hand, that means this particular hand, I need to tell with respect to some base. Use base ke with respect to where this hand is. That means I needed to do some calculations to reach to this hand so that I can manipulate with this hand if I transform my base to this particular end effector. So this is nothing but direct kinematics, which is being used over here. And we'll be studying this in this particular lecture. So the objective of this lecture is to drive a method to compute the position and orientation of the manipulators and effector relative to the base of the manipulator as a function of the joint variables. I hope this objective is clear to you, but I can further put some light on this objective to drive a method to compute the position and orientation of the manipulators and effector. जो एंड इफेक्टर है जो अभी हमने अभी वी हैव जस्ट सीन अ डायग्राम वेयर द हैंड वाज द एंड इफेक्टर एंड वी वांट टू नो द मैनिपुलेटर्स पोजीशन एंड ओरिएंटेशन ऑफ दिस एंड इफेक्टर रिलेटिव टू द बेस ऑफ द मैनिपुलेटर सो मैनिपुलेटर ओवर हियर इज अ रोबोट रिलेटिव टू द बेस ऑफ द मैनिपुलेटर एज अ फंक्शन ऑफ द जॉइंट वेरिएबल्स So joint variables, if I'm saying, these are nothing but your DH parameters, which we will be studying later on in this lecture. So right now, our objective is should be very clear that we want to know the position and orientation of the end effector with respect to the base, in a simple words, through joint variables. That is our objective to learn in this particular lecture. So next is about degrees of freedom, right? So if, when I'm saying degrees of freedom of a rigid body is defined as a number of independent movements it has, the number of independent position variables needed to locate all parts of the mechanism, different ways in which a robot arm can move and the joints. So degree of freedom is the possibly the number of coordinates which you require to define the position of the end effector. That is known as degree of freedom, right? Next, if I'm saying degree of freedom of a rigid body in a plane, then it must be clear to you that it can have two positional movements along X, along Y, and one rotational movement is also possible. So this is known as a degree of freedom of a rigid body in a plane. Then when I'm talking about in space, then there are positions possible as along X axis, along Y axis, along Z axis, then the movements along X axis, along Y axis, along Z axis. Right. So these are the movements possible in space, and accordingly, we have our degree of freedom. So when I'm saying 3D space, then there will be 6 degree of freedom possible. There would be 3 positional degree of freedom and 3 will be the orientation. In robotics, degree of freedom is the number of independently driven joints. So as degree of freedom increases, you can easily understand that your computational complexity increases, right? But your positioning accuracy decreases, your cost increases, your flexibility increases, but power transmission is more difficult. So these are the adverse pros and cons of degree of freedom. So once you are increased degree of freedom, so these are the things which will be you should keep in your mind while designing a particular robot. Now we come to the robot links and joints. You must be knowing, because we are going towards DH parameters, so at least we should have a basic knowledge that is what is a joint and what is a link. So if I'm talking about joints, then joints will be the power giving connecting mechanisms, right? And what will be the end effector performing the robotic task? Robotic task means, again, I'm talking about the final end welding or whatever the application you are interested in. So in open kinematics chains, industrial manipulators, number of degree of freedom is equal to number of joints, right? Then further throwing some light on robot joints, when I'm taking an example of Revolut joint. So over here, you can see that the first link is rotating about this particular point. Then second is rotating about this. So accordingly, you have a rotational about this as theta 2. Over here, you have theta 1. So you have a Revolut joints with 1 degree of freedom variable as theta. Similarly, we have prismatic joints, which will be the linear one. Over here, you can see that we only have a linear movement possible in and out. So this is a prismatic joint, and this is known as a Revolut joint. So we have another example of Puma 560. You can see that Puma 560 has 6 Revolut joint. A Revolut joint has 1 degree of freedom that is defined by its angle, right? Now, we are starting towards DH parameters. We are trying to define the parameters over here. Then we will talk about DH. Over here, I'm defining the parameters which will be eventually go into DH parameters. So these parameters are going to define the position and orientation of a particular joint with respect to another joint. Okay? So we are going to define the position and orientation. Right. The kinematic functions of a link is to maintain a fixed relationship between the two joint axes it supports. This relationship can be described with 2 parameters, the link length A, the link twist angle alpha, right? So, we are going to define 2 parameters over there in this slide. Ultimately, there will be 4 parameters, but over here, I'm just concerned about the link length A and the link twist angle alpha. These are the 2 parameters that I am going to define in this PPT particular slide. Now, how to measure a link twist angle alpha? You can see that I have a joint over here, a link over here having an axis I minus 1. Over here, I am having another link, which is axis I. Suppose I translate this axis I to I minus 1 like this. Right? So this particular axis is parallel to this axis I. And this axis I is making an angle alpha I minus 1 with the axis I. Now this is known as a twist angle. So what we have done, we have translated the axis I to the previous axis origin, and then what we did is we found the twisting angle. So twisting angle over here is alpha I minus 1. Second thing that we are interested into is that we have drawn an axis along the z axis of this particular link I. And similarly, we have drawn an axis I over here along Z axis. Then what we have done, we have drawn a common normal between these two axes, which are along z-axis, this length of this common normal is known as AI minus 1, which is nothing but a link length. So over here, we have defined two parameters. One is the twisting, link twist angle alpha. Another one is the link length AI minus 1. I already told you how we measure the link length. For that, we already have the axis I and I minus 1. And then what we did is we have drawn a common normal between these two axes. And the length of this common normal AI minus 1 is known as the link length A. Okay. So these are the two parameters which are associated with the link. Now we move towards next. Link length and twist, already I have explained in the previous slide, but again, if you want some clarity, another diagram has been drawn over here. So you have axis I minus 1, you have axis I. You can see that there is a common normal between the two axes, which is the link length AI minus 1. And then there is a twisting angle alpha I minus 1, which is the nothing but the angle between the two axes, I and I minus 1. So these are the two parameters which are associated with the link. Then we have a joint parameter. So two parameters were associated with the link. Now there will be two other parameters which will be associated with the joint. A joint axis is established at the connection of two links. The joint will have two normals connected to it, one for each of the links. The relative position of two links is known as link offset. The relative position of two links is called the link offset, which is denoted by dn, which is the distance between the links. I can show you in the next diagram. Over here, you can see that if this is the origin of this particular link, then along this, there will be axis X. Similarly, there is another link over here and its origin falls over here. If I further stretch these two, then I can easily find out the distance between the two X axis. One is the link I, another one is the link I minus 1. So the angle between these two, so distance between these two is known as the offset, or it is measured through a distance d. You can simply assume that if the two links are in the same plane, are parallel, are lying along the same line, then this d would be zero. अगर दोनों अपनी एक ही लाइन में पड़े होंगे तो उनका डिस्टेंस डी क्या हो जाएगा, जीरो हो जाएगा. बट बिकॉज देयर इज सम ऑफसेट बिटवीन द टू लिंक, सो देयर इज अनदर पैरामीटर विच इज रिलेटेड टू इज मेजर्ड इन अ प्लेन नॉर्मल टू द joint axis. You can see over here, I have one axis xi minus 1. There is one axis, this one, which is the x axis, and the angle between these two is known as the joint angle. ठीक है, एक तो मैंने offset ले लिया, offset is d over here, another one is the joint angle, which is theta i. उसके लिए व्हाट आई डिड इज आई हैव फॉरवर्डेड मूव इन द सेम डायरेक्शन अप रीच्ड अप टू द ओरिजिन ऑफ द सेकंड लिंक एंड देन द एंगल बिटवीन द टू एक्स एक्सिस ओवर हियर इज नोन एज द जॉइंट एंगल. सो द टू पैरामीटर्स ओवर हियर आर गिवन बाय द जॉइंट. वन इज ऑफसेट, अनदर वन इज द एंगल बिटवीन द टू एक्स एक्सिस. So now I have summarized all the four parameters. The two are associated with the link parameters, link, and two are associated with the joint. four parameters are associated with each link, you can align the two axes using these parameters. First, I have AN, the length of the link, alpha, and the twist angle between the joint axis. Next, we have joint parameters. This is denoted by theta N, the angle between the links, and the distance between the links. Okay? एक तो हो गया length of the link, एक हो गया twist angle between the joint axis, एक हो गया angle between the links and the distance between the links. So these are the four parameters which are known as the DH parameter. We'll come to that in a while, but these will be the four parameters which are going to do help us in designing the kinematics. This is another example where you can see how these four parameters are placed when two links are put side to side with each other. Already I have defined everything about it. You can see that this is my link twist angle. Already I have explained the same axis has been moved to this. This is parallel to this, and twist between them is alpha I minus 1. And then we'll be drawing a common normal between the two axes. And this is the link length A I minus 1. Then there will be some offset. Then this is noted by D. And then there is an angle between the two x axes. This is noted by theta. So these are the four parameters which I'm defining. So there are some special cases which will help or make your life easier just by looking at the diagram or looking at the two links. The one is the if joint axis ZI minus 1 and ZI, they intersect with each other, then parameter AI would be 0. Is it okay? अगर दोनों के दोनों एक्सेस, ये वाला एक्सेस आपका, ये वाला एक्सेस, इसको उठा के मैं यहीं ले जाऊं, यहां पे ले जाऊं, तो ऑटोमेटिकली मेरी लेंथ क्या हो जाएगी, ये वाली जीरो हो जाएगी, बिकॉज दिस एक्सेस हैज बीन मूव टू द प्रीवियस, राइट? मतलब सपोज ऐसा समझो कि एक लिंक है, उसके ऊपर एक और लिंक है, देन ऑब्वियसली द लिंक लेंथ वुड बी जीरो. If the common perpendicular to ZI minus 1 and ZI intersect at the origin of frame, then DI minus 1 is 0. Again, aap ye samajh lo ki agar ye dono ke dono ek hi line mein aa jayenge, to then DI would also be 0. If joint axis ZI minus 1 and ZI are parallel, then angle AI is 0. Theek hai, agar dono angle A, alpha, it should be angle alpha, then angle alpha I should be 0. Wo ऐसा ही है कि अगर दोनों के दोनों आपके एक्सिस आपस में पैरेलल हो जाएं तो ये ट्विस्ट एंगल की कोई वैल्यू नहीं रह जाती, ये भी क्या हो जाएगा, जीरो हो जाएगा. सो दीस आर द स्पेशल केसेस, मींस आई एम जस्ट इंट्रोड्यूसिंग यू टू द कॉन्सेप्ट दैट बाय जस्ट लुकिंग एट द डायग्राम सम ऑफ द पैरामीटर्स इमीडिएटली यू कैन पुट जीरो. दैट विल मेक योर लाइफ इजियर वंस यू आर एबल टू आइडेंटिफाई विच पैरामीटर्स वुड बी जीरो. क्योंकि अगर चार पैरामीटर हैं और मैं ऑल द फोर पैरामीटर्स की वैल्यू लेके चलूंगा, डेफिनेटली वंस आई एम गोइंग टू सॉल्व इट थ्रू द ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन मैट्रिक्स, माय लाइफ वुड बी लिटिल बिट डिफिकल्ट बिकॉज आई नीड टू डू ऑल द कैलकुलेशन. बट इफ आई जस्ट बाय लुकिंग एट द डायग्राम आई एम एबल टू आइडेंटिफाई दैट ईदर द लिंक लेंथ ए इज जीरो और द टू एक्सेस आर पैरेलल और डी इज जीरो, देन जस्ट बाय पुटिंग दोस वैल्यूज इन द मैट्रिक्स एज जीरो माई सॉल्विंग द मैट्रिक्स वुड बिकम easier. So that's why these are the special cases which are being introduced to you so that you can understand them and you can just identify just by looking at the diagram. Next important thing is to affix the frames to the links. In order to describe the location of each link relative to its neighbors, we define a frame attached to each link. I told you the axis Z axis is coincident with joint axis I. यही किया हमने अभी तक कि हम लोग Z axis जो ले रहे थे हम ये वाला उसी के लॉन्ग आपका axis भी है which is the of the link I. तो वो भी हो गया हमारे पास. The origin of frame is located where AI perpendicular intersects the joint I axis. ठीक है. The origin of frame is located where AI perpendicular intersects the joint axis. Again, you can understand that ki जिस जगह पे जाके वो इंटरसेक्ट करेगा नेक्स्ट वाला, अगर इसको मैं इसको पीछे ले जाके यहां पे किया तो ये इसका ओरिजिन आ गया। अब ये इसके अगले वाला जो लिंक होगा उसको जब इसके साथ इंटरसेक्ट करा होगा मैंने, तो यहाँ पे इस वाले लिंक का ओरिजिन आ गया। तो मतलब ये वाला जो आपका प्रीवियस पे जाके इंटरसेक्ट करता है वहां पे आपको क्या मिलता है, ओरिजिन मिलता है उसका। तो अब आपने जेड एक्सिस भी फिक्स कर दिया, आपने यू हैव फिक्स द ओरिजिन एज वेल। एक्स एक्सिस ऑलवेज पॉइंट्स अलोंग ए आई फ्रॉम आई टू आई प्लस वन, और ए आई कहां किधर होता है, दैट इज अलोंग द कॉमन नॉर्मल बिटवीन द टू एक्सिस। सो फर्स्ट व्हाट वुड वी वुड डू, वी वुड ड्रॉ कॉमन नॉर्मल बिटवीन टू एक्सिस आई एंड आई प्लस वन, एंड देन वेयर दैट कॉमन नॉर्मल इज मूविंग फ्रॉम द ओरिजिन, दैट विल बी योर एक्सिस। इफ टू एक्सिस आर इंटरसेक्टिंग ईच अदर देन योर कॉमन नॉर्मल विल बी जीरो, इन दैट केस योर एक्सिस इज परपेंडिकुलर टू एक्सिस आई एंड आई प्लस वन। And now you have got x axis, you have got z axis, the only remaining axis is y axis. So how to identify y axis? That will be through right hand rule. So by using all those rules, you have defined z axis, x axis and y axis. Right? This is nothing but the same diagram which is now shown with three joints, joint n, n minus 1 and n plus 1. So what we have done is there is a axis which is along z axis, then there is an x axis which is along the common normal between the two links, then from the plus I plus 1 to I, wherever it is intersecting, you are getting an origin, and then you're using right hand rule to get the direction of the y. So you have got x, you have got z, you have got y, and then there is offset dn, then your alpha angle. So all those things now should be clear to you, or you need to do some practice after this lecture. If you are interested into this, then it will be easier immediately doing some practice, because that will means make you closer to these dh parameters. Okay. The parameter di is algebraic and may be negative. It is constant if joint I is revolute and variable when joint I is prismatic. That can easily be understood. अगर revolute है तो वो एक ही जगह पे खड़ा हुआ revolute करता रहेगा, तो उनकी आपस की जो distance है offset है वो that is not going to change. But if it is prismatic, then definitely offset is going to change. Either it is decreasing or increasing. Accordingly, your di will increase or decrease. The parameter AI is always constant and positive because it's a common normal. It is always away from the origin. So it is always taken as positive and it is always constant. Now, this is your final equation, the transformation matrix. You must have studied what is transformation matrix. Now, over here, what is T1, T2, T3, TI and TN? What are they representing? They are representing the relative axis. Suppose from base to I want to move to axis 1, then T1 will be my that matrix which will be transforming the axis from the base to the first axis. And then from first to second, second to third, third to ith, ith to n. So once I'm able to do that, that means I have transformed my axis from the base to the nth axis. Nth means the end effector. So ultimately, what I am doing is I am multiplying the transformation matrices. So if I am able to find out one transformation matrix, that means the matrix from 0 to 1, then similarly, if I am able to find out the matrix for transformation from 1 to 2, when I am saying transformation, so that means I'm concerned about two things. One is position, another one is orientation. So I need to keep in my mind that there will be two changes when I'm moving from axis 1 to 2, and either of them can be zero also depending upon whether the two axes are parallel or their axes are coincident. So accordingly, I need to design my transformation matrix at each individual link. So if suppose I have six links in a six axis robotic arm, then I need to have six transformation matrices. Right. So once I'm able to write down all the six transformation matrices by using DH parameters, then multiplying all those would give me the transformation from the base to the sixth or the end effector. I hope things are clear till now. Now, I need to write down the transformation matrices. When I'm talking about transformation matrices, I need to have few parameters. These parameters are known as Dynamit-Hartenberg DH parameters. Okay, so this is same. I don't want to go about it. So this diagram again represents all those four parameters which I have defined since the starting of this lecture: the link length A, the twist angle alpha, the offset D, and the joint angle theta. All those four parameters have been shown over here, which already I have described to you. Okay, so these four parameters are nothing but DH parameters. Now, how to measure these parameters? In which direction they will be positive? About what axis we should measure them? So this slide completely explains that thing. If I'm talking about AI, how to measure AI, then this is the distance from ZI to ZI plus one measured along XI. Okay? Already I've told you ki sabse pehle what we'll do. We will draw a common normal between the two axes. Like you can see over here, this is ZI, this is ZI minus one. So we have drawn a common normal between these two axes. Then along XXI, this AI will be taken as positive, and this is where we want to measure the distance. Next, we have alpha I. So alpha I is the twist angle. Already I have explained to you in the previous slides as well, the angle between ZI and ZI plus one measured about XI. Right? Then we have DI, the distance from XI minus one to XI measured along ZI. You can imagine this. ये मेरा XI minus one है, ये XI है, दोनों के बीच का जो डिस्टेंस है उसे हम ऑफसेट बोलते हैं, एंड दिस ऑफसेट इज नोन एज द DI. सिमिलरली द एंगल बिटवीन XI minus one टू XI मेजर्ड अलोंग ZI. ठीक है, तो दिस इज माय ट्विस्ट एंगल थीटा. तो यू कैन सी दैट इन लिंक पैरामीटर्स वी मेजर बिटवीन ZIs and we measured along XI, but in joint angle we measured the distance or orientation between XI, but we measured along ZI. So these are the two things you need to keep in your mind. Next comes DH convention: assign x-axis, start at base and assign frames 1 to n, pick x-axis and origin. Y-axis chosen to form a right-hand system. Consider three cases: not coplanar, parallel, and intersecting. These three cases are the special cases. Okay. You just take a general example, then these cases will automatically be covered. Okay. So, but if you want to go into specific into these, and then you can consider that these are the not coplanar, parallel, and intersecting ones. ZI minus one and ZI are not coplanar. Common normal to axis is the link axis. Intersection with ZI is the origin. So these things are repeated again and again so that you should have a clear picture about these axes. Because once you should be very much conversant with these four parameters, because you need to put these four parameters in the complex six axis or four axis robotic arm. So these are when the two axes are parallel. So when two are parallel, then alpha would be zero, because that is a twist angle between the two axes. And similarly, the link length would be the common normal between the two axes. Then we have DH convention: x-axis, if joint axis ZI minus one and ZI intersect, XI is normal to the plane containing the axis. XI is equal to ZI minus one into ZI. That to be multiplied, taking plus minus, so this is there. These are the same thing. I won't be going into detail on these. Okay, now we'll talk about general transformation between two axes, two bodies. In DH convention, a general transformation between two bodies is defined as a product of four basic transformations. A translation along the initial z-axis by d. Look, abhi, what we are talking about, we want to transform the axis from one axis to another. What we need to do is how we can transform. We want to bring the second axis to the origin of the first. We want to align the two axes. We want to align the twist angles so that the second axis becomes exactly the replica of the first axis. Once we are able to, we are moving backwards, right? Suppose we want to compare two persons or two countries, right? What we need to do is we need to pick some parameters on the basis of which we want to compare two countries. What we do is we will try to find out the difference between on those parameters. That can be income per capita, or that can be population, or that can be resources available. So we need to define some parameters, and then we need to compare those parameters. Suppose this is the total difference between one parameter. Similarly, over here, what I'm doing is we are having two axes, and there are some parameter associated with those axes. That parameter is nothing but the DH parameter. Now, what we are doing is we are trying to align the two axes with each other. Exactly replica. And while we are doing this, we are moving backward. We are doing reverse engineering, and we want to align the second axis with respect to one. For doing that, we need to move four parameters. Once we are able to know the values of those parameters, what are those four parameters values which make the second axis exactly replica of the first, then we can immediately assume that how first axis would move to the second axis by having those values inserted into that. This is how we are transforming one to another. Right? Suppose we want to match our country with another country. Once we are able to identify the difference between the two parameters, then if we increase those parameters and reach to the same level to the second country, then we can say that at least with those parameters, our countries are alike. Similarly, over here, we are just doing some orientation, position with the four parameters. We are trying to find out the values. Once we are able to find out those values, then our transformation matrix would be ready. And then multiplying all those transformation matrix according to the number of the links available in the robotic arm, then we are able to transform the base to the end effector. So we have rotation about initial axis, about Z, and the translation along x-axis by A, rotation about the new axis by alpha. This is how our transformation matrix has been written. So it is moving from I minus 1 to I, right? Or reverse, you can say that. Okay. Suppose I want to move from I to I plus 1 by using DH parameters. Then I need to have the four possible transformations. One is transformation about angle, transformation about offset, which is prismatic distance, transformation with the link length, and then transformation about the twist angle. Right? So, when I do these four transformations, that means that will be the total transformation matrix, which will be involving all the four parameters. So, if you can see that in the first matrix, I'm not doing anything else. I'm just twisting the two axes with respect to each other according to the angle between them. And that is the theta, the joint angle. Okay. And then we are doing a prismatic. And prismatic, this is the transformation matrix, which is beyond my lecture, because you must be knowing these transformation matrix. You must have studied even in your CAD/CAM in your 8th semester in BTech, where we do all these transformation matrix. I think it's too easy to understand. Because 10010, and then we have a DI. DI is the distance along Z axis. Then similarly over here, distance along X axis, which is taken as AI, otherwise all will be kept as zero. And this is my identity matrix. Similarly, I will be having my twisting angle, which is alpha over here. So this is my fourth matrix. So I need to multiply all these four matrix. Then this is my transformation matrix for moving from one axis to another axis. So I need to have six such matrices to move from base to the end effector. So this is one matrix is ready. This is the first one matrix, which is ready with me. Similarly, I have DH transformation for adjacent coordinate frames. So this is my final matrix, which I need to remember. I need to find out the values between the two axes. I need to put those values over here. So then my first matrix would be ready. Similarly, I will repeat my process for all the six axes, and then multiplying all those transformation matrix will give me the total transformation. For that, just to start, because this is the first lecture where you are understanding the DH parameter and then you want to understand the transformation, then we are taking very simple example to start with. I'm just taking an example of academic manipulator. Over here, academic manipulator, you can see there are three revolute joint. We have joint one, joint two, joint three. Then we have similarly link one, link two, and link three. So while I'm moving from joint one to joint two, you can see that there is a 90 degree rotation from joint one to joint two, while joint two and joint three are parallel to each other. Okay, just a simple observation which you can immediately see from this diagram. So Zi is axis of actuation for joint I plus one. Z naught and Z1 are not coplanar because they are having an angle of 90 degree with each other, while Z1 and Z2 are parallel to each other. So Z naught and Z1 are not coplanar. So X naught is the common normal between them. Similarly, we have X1 is a common normal between Z1 and Z2. Similarly, we have a X2 is a common normal between Z2 and Z3. Similar. So you can see the rotation angle as well. While rotating about Z0, about Z1, about Z2, it means there is a rotation possible. So accordingly, there will be theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3 would be there. So those parameters will also be come into picture. So you can see the rotation. Theta 1 is possible, theta 2 is possible, theta 3 is possible. So these are the angles which are possible. Similarly, you have one twist angle alpha I, then there are parallel. So there will not be any twisting angle. So twisting angles would be zero for all other links. This is your transformation matrix, which I am trying to find out. But before that, we need to have the values of the four parameters. So the four parameters are theta, D, alpha, and A. So we have link one, two, and three. And accordingly, we'll try to find out the, because there is a rotation about Z axis, about joint is possible. So that means there will be all thetas are possible, theta one, theta two, theta three, because there is no offset, all lie along the single line. So you have D 0, 0, 0, 0. There is only one twisting angle possible between Z1 and Z2. So you have only one 90 degree angle over here, others are zero. Then if I'm talking about link length is the common normal between two Z axis. So over here it is taken as R, then L1 and L2. These are your common normal values. So you have found all the values for the four parameters. Now you have the transformation matrix, which I have discussed in the previous slides. So you have all the things available over here. You have the values. What you need to do is you need to put those values over here. And accordingly, you will be having your first transformation matrix, your second transformation matrix, your third transformation matrix. And ultimately, what you will do, you will multiply all those three transformation matrices and you will get your final position. This is how our DH parameter would work. So with that, because I don't want to go beyond that, because that will be like more than what is expected, because it will ultimately, my final aim would be to go to Puma 560, but that is not possible in a single lecture. So I have just introduced you to the DH parameter. Just go back. If you are interested, you can study it. And then ultimately you try to solve the Puma 560 assignment. And Puma 560 assignment is going to means make you fully conversant with the DH parameter. Because this is sometimes, because being a six-axis robotic arm, this will help you out, understand each and other robotic arms. With that, thank you so much for joining my lecture. So I'm just resting my lecture over here. Thank you so much. Vimlesh?
So thank you so much, sir. Now the session is open for question answer session. So if any participants have any query, you are welcome for any questions. You can also type your question. I can read it for sir. And you have also access to unmute yourself if you want to ask anything. Okay, I'm sharing the attendance link. So one question is that DH parameters are responsible for the transformation either in forward or backward kinematics.
See, Kavita, the thing is that DH parameters are just the four parameters which are going to give you the values between the two links, right? Or two joints. Then it is up to you whether you are moving for forward kinematics or backward kinematics. You need to have the values between the relation between the two links and two joints. Then it is up to you to move forward or to backward. So it will be helpful for you in both the things.
Thank you so much, sir. I hope there is no, I can see there is no any more questions. So thank you for joining us, sir. Thank you for your lectures.
Thank you, Milesh. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. So dear participants, I have shared the attendance link in the chat box. Please mark your attendance through the chat box. And one more very important announcement which I like to share with you. Jo hamara third session hoga, 2:30 baje se chalu hoga, that is the valedictory session of this program. So 2:30 baje se session chalu hoga, and which is mandatory for certification. So first of all, valedictory hoga, hamare guest aayenge, wo aapko sambodhit karenge. Aur jaise hi valedictory session khatam ho gaya, होगा इन द सेम मीटिंग चैट बॉक्स आई विल शेयर द लिंक फॉर प्रोग्राम टेस्ट. सो उसके लिए आपको 10 क्वेश्चन होंगे, 10 एमसीक्यू क्वेश्चन, एंड आपके पास 10 मिनट्स होंगे, आप उसको मार्क करना है. और उसके बाद उसमें 5 क्वेश्चन फीडबैक के होंगे, उसके लिए आपके 5 मिनट होंगे, वो उसको मार्क करना है. सो आई होप आप 2:30 बजे प्लीज 5 मिनट्स पहले ही ज्वाइन कीजिएगा. एंड थैंक यू फॉर योर कोऑपरेशन. इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चंस और डाउट रिगार्डिंग दिस, यू कैन आस्क, यू कैन अनम्यूट एंड आस्क टू मी. एनीवन हैव एनी क्वेरी और एनी क्वेश्चन रिगार्डिंग दिस, दे कैन आस्क. Okay, I hope there is no question. So I hope to meet you at 2:25 sharp. Thank you all. Thank you. In between, please mark your attendance. मैंने इसलिए meeting close नहीं कर रहा हूँ कि आप attendance का link mark कर लो. I am again sharing, जिसने mark नहीं किया वो mark कर ले. सभी लोग प्लीज अपने अटेंडेंस मार्क कर दीजिए इस सेशन के, लिंक मैंने शेयर कर रखा है।